I've been singing this song for the past few days. I just can't get it out of my mind. It's like, I love that song. It's Joss Stone. It's Joss Stone. What were we thinking? I think that girl is bad. I just love it. So I've been thinking about that song for the past few days. I just had to play a little bit of that in the intro. I wanted to talk to you all today. Got a lot of my work out the way. It's Thursday night. It's the end of the week. And I've got time to do videos and talk about things that I'm thinking about and want to share. The house is totally quiet. My husband's at work. I don't have anything pressing to do, so I can share and I can talk with you guys. So let me get comfortable. Let me get comfortable because I want to talk about some things tonight in a short amount of time. I'm not going to take a long time doing this video, but I want to talk about something that I think is really important. And I'm entitling this video, A Labor of Love. A labor of love, a ministry of love, doing something not because you particularly want to do it, because there could be so many reasons why you don't want to do it, but doing it because it's the right thing to do and because love is guiding you. Love is undergirding your reason for why you're doing what you're doing. It is the stimulus that is causing you to respond in the way that you're doing. Even, and this is the most important part, it's even in the midst of confrontation. That's it. I'm saying this because I've got something going on that I'm always challenged with, and it's a family member. And I did a video a short while ago about what did I title that video? I don't even remember what it was called, but it was my last video that I did. And it was basically about dealing with people who you don't necessarily choose. And that's family. We do not pick our family. We have friends that we can select, that we can choose our friends, but we cannot pick our family. And when you cannot pick your family, you're liable to deal with all sorts of things. You know, we have a tendency to put up with things from our family members that we would not normally deal with friends. Why is that? Because they're family, because they're blood. And I don't know about you, but I will go the extra mile to love on you, to support you, to forgive you, to try to be more empathetic and sympathetic to you because you're my brother, or you're my sister, or you're my dad, or you're my you know, whatever it may be. I'll go that extra mile because the family bond is important. It's important that families support each other. I mean, if you can't find love and support within your own family unit, it's really hard. I don't know how hard it is because it's probably where gangs start forming at. You know, if you watch, you know, documentaries and listen to interviews and things, some of the main things that gang members say is that they didn't have love in the home. You know, the family unit was destructive or wasn't supportive or wasn't, you know, conducive to relationships. So they went outside of that to go find family bonds. And I believe that if you can't connect and love those that are in your family, and love them in spite of themselves, in spite of the differences, and in spite of the problems, then you really can't love properly. Because I believe love starts at home. I believe that love, the home environment, the family environment, is the environment that really ought to teach us how to love properly. You know, so that we can love ourselves and be able to give that back. I'm dealing with a situation where I know this individual has concerns, that worries and fears that they're dealing with. They're going through a sickness. They're dealing with a sickness that's major, that is life-threatening. And a lot of the time, they're angry, you know, frustrated, lashing out, you know, using language that is unpleasant, and I'm using that, you know, word loosely. They're using language that is not conducive, you know, to a loving relationship. You know, from an elder to a younger, it's not. It's just not. And I know this individual loves me. I know that they don't mean the things that they're saying. I mean, I think he means it for the most part. But I do believe that in his heart, that his frustrations with what he's dealing with cause him to lash out at the people who are close to him, the people who love him. And I am the person who is responsible for carrying a lot of the bulk of the problem. I take care of the, you know, the writing of checks. I take care of the medicine. I take care of the doctor's visits and calls. I do that. You know, I'm there to ask questions, right? You know, if there's something about a medicine, I'm there. If you got to go to your lawyer's office and deal with business things, I'm there. I'm the one who does that. So I'm very dependent. I'm very dependable. When it comes to handling business and issues, I'm functional. I'm on top of that. I want to be on top of it. It's not even that it's a burden, even though it does require a lot of my time and I'm emotionally carrying baggage. It's a lot of work. You know, the caregiver is required to carry a lot of baggage, and it affects your home life and your personal life. It just does, you know. And to have somebody use language that is foul, that is distasteful, to be in a, you know, to just do things that are, you know, unpleasant and toxic to the spirit, it's hard. It's hard to deal with it sometimes because you can get frustrated. I get frustrated. All right. And I had to make a peace. I'm sharing all of this because I think that at some point or the other, you know, with parents especially, if we live long enough, we are going to get old. We're going to get older one day. If God gives us long life, we'll grow old one day. And we will need someone to care for us, to love us, to support us, to be forgiving, to show compassion and mercy. And if it were not for the relationship that I have with God, if God were not giving me the faith, if God was not my guide, my center, I wouldn't be able to deal with this situation because I would be lashing out. I would be reciprocating the words. I would be reciprocating the can't get back at you. I'm going to get you back. It just wouldn't be functional. It wouldn't be a good relationship. I wouldn't be able to love. I wouldn't be able to help, and I would not be able to get beyond the you should've, you can't, you wouldn't. I wouldn't be able to get beyond that if it were not because of the love of God in my heart that makes me want to be forgiving and to show mercy to people who are unkind at times. You know, we've all been there. And I say a labor of love because at some point, if you are a mature person, and we're all human. We all break at one point. But I believe that a person who's mature and is really trying to walk with God, trying to live in harmony with people and with themselves, if you truly have incurred or benefited from the grace of a forgiving God, if you believe the scriptures in that he loved us before we loved him, and that he died for us because you know, we were in sin and ungodly. If you believe those things and take it to heart, then you will, by the grace of God, simply because of mercy's sake, you will learn how to forgive other people and operate in a position of love in spite of people's differences. And I'm dealing with this. I'm practicing this all the time. And it's making me stronger. And I'm able to help my siblings because I'm telling them that, you know, this is what we got to do. This is how we got to do this because, you know, Dad is not in his, you know, he's not the best. He's just, you know, dealing with a lot of stuff that's on his plate. And unless you are grounded, this is key, unless the individual who is struggling to be productive in the environment, if they're the one that's lashing out, that's having a difficult time getting along with people, unless that individual is in Christ or in a meaningful relationship with the Creator, they don't have a conscience and a conviction in their spirit to want to be right. They may feel remorseful for a time, but there's nothing restraining them to keep them from doing it again. You got to keep speaking love to that person. You got to keep showing them love. You got to keep demonstrating acts of kindness in spite of. This is the ministry of love. This is the labor of love, and that we love even when people are unkind, because that's what Christ did for us. Scripture says, and he died for the ungodly even while we were yet sinners. And I'm paraphrasing, but even while we were yet in our sin, Christ died for us. And realizing that I was such a bad person, and my dad compensated for me sometime. He helped me out. He did. I mean, more than sometime, you know, and I did not always like his approach. I did not like the way he chastened, but in the hour of need, he was available to me. And as he gets older and deals with sickness, it is a way for me to give back in spite of his conversation, in spite of his judgmental personality and his critical tongue. I'm able to give back and look beyond that. And this is the message. I mean, we have to love and show love in spite of, because we have a labor of love, a ministry of love to give. And I don't know if you believe like I do. I don't know if you're a Christian. I don't know if faith is important to you. I don't know if God is the source of your strength. I don't know what you're hoping in or what you are placing your trust in. I can only speak for me and what helps me. But I know that at the end of the day, it is important to have a place to make your petitions known, to pray. It is important to have that connection, to be able to reach out and connect to something that's greater than us. I am so shallow in my thinking. As you know, as knowledgeable and as gifted as I am with the gifts that God has given me, and I don't mind saying that. I'm not being conceited. I'm not being boasters. God has given me gifts. God has used me to be effective in some areas. I own that. He just has. It just is. I mean, and he's done the same thing for you. But even with the gifts that we have, the things that the Lord allows us to use to benefit and to edify others, if we're not merciful, if we're not showing love, it is as a tinkling cymbal. All of the things and the good things that we can do, all of the gifts and abilities that we have, unless we're showing love in it and being merciful to others, I think we're missing the mark. So I just wanted to share this tonight because I had time to do so, and because my sharing with you helps me. It really does. It helps me. And I think that we all can do better with showing love to each other. You know, it might not be your turn today, but tomorrow it could be, you know. So let's just work on self. Let's just try to be more loving, more kind. Let us operate in that labor of love, ministry of love. Let's just do it. It is truly, it is for me a labor of love. I'm doing this because I love him. I'm operating out of love because not only does he need me to, but I need him. I need this. It's making me stronger. It's making me wiser. It's given me spiritual muscle. It's given me something to stand on. I'm growing. And I just give God the glory for it. I thank you guys for listening. I thank you for watching my videos. I thank you for your supportive comments and for the things that you have to say. And let's just try and be better. That's what it's all about in 2:11. And as 2:12 quickly approaches, it's all about pressing forward, not growing weary and well-doing, but just continuing to do the best that we can do, striving and reaching for our goals. goals to be better, to live better, to think better, to treat other people better. Because when we do all of those things, God is going to take pleasure in those things that we're doing. And he's going to bless his efforts. He's going to bless the workmanship in us. So thank you so much. It's been a longer video than I intended, but I hope that you stay with me. God bless you. Bye-bye.